Hello and welcome! If you love playing team-based games and are wondering how to add this kind of game mode to your island, well, you're in the right place because Search and Destroy is the perfect game for the whole family. Assuming you have a large family that likes to compete against each other and blow things up. Search and Destroy is an elimination-based game with a lot of critical settings. Fair warning, S&D does require more setup than other game modes in this series. However, learning how to make this mode work will help as you build more and more complex islands. Now, where was I? Oh yeah, Search and Destroy, or S&D if you're cool. One team works together as the attacking side. Their objective is to plant a bomb, while the other side is the defending team, with a mission to stop those attackers from successfully planting their bomb. Or you could just win by obliterating the other side. There are many key components to a successful Search and Destroy game, with the actual island layout being one of the most important. How your players move around the island, the flow of the players going from their start points to the bomb locations, and how you want them to run into each other determines how frantic the game is and will lead them to either play for the bomb or for the eliminations. You can design your island to lead the players toward a central area to encourage them to come together to fight. Or you can have corridors and rooms between the two groups of players with many ways in and out to enable them to search for the other team and to use the bomb as the win condition. Now, for the tech. Lots and lots of tech. First up, head over to My Island Settings to start your S&D build. Select the Game tab, and just to be sure, set everything back to its default settings. Perfect! Next, set your max players to the amount you want. 8 will work. While you're here, go ahead and set the teams to 2. To keep those rounds moving quickly, set the spawn limit to 1. This way, when a player is eliminated, they become a spectator until the next round begins. Pro tip, selecting an odd number of rounds is a good idea to avoid ties. 5 will work well for this example. As you know, in this game mode, one side is the attackers and the other is the defenders. However, you can actually rotate which side is doing what. For now, choose every round, but know you have other fun options to try out later. To keep the game fun for everyone, set your end game on match point to yes. No one wants to keep playing when they've already lost. For time limit, you'll set 5 minutes for now. Continuing down, set game win condition to most round wins. Set spectating other teams to no. That way, you don't get any sneaky cheaters watching the other team. Moving right along to the settings tab, you will notice here that you can decide whether you want to allow building and destruction in your game or not. For this example, you will do a no build and no destruction game. To make a no build game, start by selecting none for allowing building. To ensure players can't destroy anything, including your bomb sites, you will choose no for the can destroy environment, turn off environmental damages, and finally pickaxe destruction to none. An essential part of this game mode is the scoreboard. In the UI tab, you can set your displays and scoreboard. Pause the video here to check how this example scoreboard was set up. Just so you're aware, this example is not how your game should be laid out. This is a simple level layout to help you understand how S&D works. You will not put the sequencers in the play area. You'll want 2 team settings and inventory pads, player spawn pads, 1 timed objective, 1 explosive, 2 HUD display devices, 3 triggers, and 2 sequencers. Let's lay them out like this. Great, you've done it! Just kidding, you're like 30% there. Let's get all this stuff connected. Set up your player spawns for Team 1 and Team 2. Easy, let's move on. Go to your team settings and inventory here. For Team 2, name it and set the team designator here. Set it up to end round and when receiving from this trigger. And when it's out of respawns, it will transmit to this trigger. Next, Team 1. Same setup, but have it end round when it gets a signal from this trigger and transmit it to this trigger. Move over to the timed objective in the middle. You'll name it Bomb, set the Start Team filter to Team 1, and set the Start Interact text to Plant the Bomb. That way, only one team will receive the message to plant. Next, you'll do the inverse for Team 2. They will be the defenders. So you'll set the Stop Team filter to Team 2, and the Stop Interact text will be Deactivate the Bomb. Set the Stop Score and the Complete Score both to 100. Use mesh options to add the explosive attachment. Finally, set it up so when started, we'll transmit to this trigger. When stopped, we'll transmit to this sequencer. When completed, we'll transmit to the explosive device. Here you'll see how these signals are flowing. You've made it so if Team 2 stops the bomb, that instantly sends a signal back to the team pad to end the game. More on this later, but this communication is how you'll build your functionality. Now, the explosive. You can play with all the settings here. The critical setting for now is this. Make it indestructible. Blast radius of 0.25, structure damage, 0. The communications will be explode when receiving from the timed objective, and when exploded, transmit to this sequencer. Almost there! Now you'll connect your triggers. Go to your first trigger and set it to transmit to the Team 1 settings and inventory pad when triggered. Move to your second trigger and set it to be disabled when the timer starts, and enabled when it's complete and the bomb explodes. And make it so it will trigger when receiving from the Team 1 settings and inventory pad. And when triggered, transmit to the Team 2 settings and inventory pad. The last trigger is simple. You'll want to transmit to Team 2 settings and inventory pad when triggered. Then, you'll use sequencers to set off the triggers. Sequencers are a great way to allow gameplay actions to register before an event. Yes, you can simply send the same signal directly to the trigger if you want to. But in this case, you're going to want that tiny delay to let the bomb explode and the score to register before the endgame signal is sent. So these sequencers will do that for you. You will set it to start when receiving a transmission from the explosive, and the second one will begin when receiving a signal from the timed objective. As mentioned before, don't put your sequencers in the play area. For now, you have them here just to make them easier to get to. Phew! Last steps now. Don't worry, these are easy. You'll program your HUD message devices to tell players their roles at the start of each match. HUD message device 1 will tell Team 1, "You're the attackers, plant the explosive." And HUD message device 2 will tell Team 2, "You're the defenders, protect or defuse the bomb." Let's take a look at your marvelous work. Here's what you've made. If Team 1 completes the mission, the timed objective sends a signal to the bomb, and the bomb explodes. The explosion signals the sequencer hits the trigger, and the trigger sends a signal to the team settings and inventory pad to end the round. Whew! However, if Team 2 stops the timer, the transmission goes to the other sequencer, which hits the trigger, and Team 2 wins instead. But you also want a winner if a team is eliminated. So if Team 1 is out of respawns, their team settings and inventory pad transmit to this trigger, which sends its signal to end the game and Team 2 wins. And the opposite is true for Team 2, of course. Then you added a failsafe. The failsafe is to make sure points are given if the bomb explodes even after Team 1 is eliminated. So you send a signal to disable this trigger when Team 1 starts the objective timer. And it stays that way until the other team stops the timer or the bomb explodes. It's a complex system of transmissions, but when you lay it out in one group like this, it's easy to follow. That's it, the basic-ish setup. You can test it, play it, add weapons, go wild! All these options can be easily adjusted, even during gameplay, so you can keep them guessing the whole time.